Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Tournament Center here at Pro Tour Magic Origins. I'm Brian David Marshall. I am joined here in Vancouver by Daniel Fournier. You may recognize Daniel from the Canadian national team last year, two-time Grand Prix top eight competitor, and he is playing a deck packed with, well, packed with packs. Talk to us a little bit about what you thought about coming into this tournament and what you, where your team ended up.
So the team and I, we've all been playing like Abzan decks and stuff forever, but Abzan just seemed like such an insanely boring choice for this tournament. Everyone's out gunning for it. What we thought the biggest deck would be, and we were right, was Red Green Devotion, and that deck just crushes Abzan. We don't want to be playing that game, so we looked to other stuff. We started with this pack deck. It's like the blue-black deck that Ali Entrazi posted a while ago, and it was not very good.
Okay.
But this is a Lucas Siao deck, and he kept working at it because he loves this kind of stuff. Ended up with the Sultai deck, and it's been really sweet so far.
Well, let's take a look. You got a lot of tools to work with in Magic Origins.
Oh, yeah.
You know, we see a bunch of cards here. J-Spring's Prodigy, Languish, and, of course, talk to us a little bit about Demonic Pact. We'll go back to the Jace in a moment.
So Demonic Pact is a bad Cruel Ultimatum. And it turns out that bad Cruel Ultimatum is still amazing. So it keeps you in games, it gives you insurmountable card advantage, and it also says you lose the game. Fortunately, we have a bunch of ways to work around that, so it's not all bad.
You have ways to forestall the inevitable?
Oh yeah, plenty. Okay. Well, I'm sure we'll see them on a later slide.
Sure. So when you play the card, what's the first, when do you play this card? Do you just put this card into play on turn four?
Absolutely.
You do?
If we can play it on turn four and not immediately lose, almost always do it, because it is Cruel Ultimatum. Okay. Early Cruel Ultimatum is good.
All right, so you put it down on turn four. What is the first thing you do?
It totally depends. So there's a lot of matchups where you just immediately force something to like try to stay in the game. The life gain is like huge. Sometimes you just discard two. You usually hold that one until you can mind rot them at like a very good time. Very frequently, you just draw two cards first.
Okay.
Don't pick you lose the game first. That's a bad idea.
We want to save that one. We don't want to ultimately have to choose that one.
Correct.
Now, Jace Vryn's Prodigy, come on over here, talk a little bit about this. Where does this card fit in for you?
Jace is pretty much the glue that fits the whole deck together. It's a very strong card. It flips extremely easy because we have Seder Wayfinders that we're going to see later. It makes sure that you hit your land drops, make sure you have the specific removal spells that line up with what your opponent's doing, lets you find Languish so you don't get overwhelmed, and once it flips, it lets you not care about crappy creatures. It blanks like 2/2s all the time, just make sure that you can focus on developing your game plan rather than killing crappy creatures to not die.
It also, sometimes when it's transformed, it lets you return.
Oh yeah, it's also part of the glue that makes sure you don't die to you lose the game. Make sure that you have the cards available to bounce your Demonic Pact 2 through 8 times.
Languish, is Languish all that was advertised?
Yeah. It doesn't kill Siege Round, it doesn't kill Polychronos, but you can beat those cards with all the other spells in your deck. It ensures that you just don't die. Turn four rather than turn five is a huge difference, especially because we want to have the mana for Demonic Pact. A lot of games you can go Demonic Pact into Languish and that kills Siege Rhinos and Polychronos and stuff. It's very important that it doesn't cost 5 like Crux of Fate does.
Explain a little bit the interaction when you have a Jace, you're in a position to transform it and what you can do between Jace and Languish.
So sometimes Languish kills Jace. Very rarely because by turn four, you're actually usually able to flip him very well. You got fetch lands, you got Thought Seizes, you got all that stuff going on. Maybe you'll pop a removal spell to kill a 5/5 and then flip Jace, then Languish. But I mean, if your Languish is killing your Jace, that's usually not a big deal because you're resolving a Languish, which is probably killing all their stuff too. So.
But if you get to transform,
you cast Languish, then you Languish. You just
then
win.
You and they play a creature, you get to plus Jace, and then maybe
Languish
throw back.
Next turn.
Yeah,
if you
Languish
have
next
to,
turn
like,
again. Yeah.
Snapcaster Mage is good.
It's kind of disgusting. We got one Nissa Vastwood Seer in the deck. She's showing her mean side here. But let's move on and look at some of the other cards you talked about already. Seder Wayfinder. This card has been an all-star for as long as it's been in Standard now. What is Seder Wayfinder doing for you?
So it's really bad. It's a 2-mana 1/1 that gets you a land. It just doesn't impact the board in any meaningful way. But it's just like Jace, it's part of just the glue that makes everything work. You need to hit your land drops, but it's like a land drop that fuels all the other cards in your deck. Like all three of these cards and one of the cards in the previous page, those are all good with Seder Wayfinder. It just makes everything tick.
So Seder Wayfinder into Tassigar gives you a pretty formidable board and presence.
Yeah.
Seder Wayfinder putting good cards in your graveyard. Den Protector lets you grow them back.
Yeah.
And then who doesn't love to dig through time?
It ensures that like if the only bounce spells you have are Jace and Den Protector, it makes it so that, not bounce spells, the only ways for you to not die to your pact are Jace and Den Protector. You'll like put a card in your graveyard and you'll be able to flash it back with those cards and
oh sure.
Lets you not die.
So like, even though you're tutoring for a land, because you're putting cards in your yard, graveyard,
you'll
also
be able to get them back
the
later with the seven Snapcaster Mages in the deck.
Okay. So let's take a look. At some more of the cards here. Ugin the Spirit Dragon.
Gotta win somehow.
Really, is that where you end up winning?
I've had a lot of games where it's just Ugin wipe the board, bolt you, bolt you, bolt you, bolt you, that's game.
Okay. A single Murderous Cut, just...
You don't want to play four Downfall. Murderous Cut's good. You have Wayfinders. It's just a good card.
Why not four Downfall?
It's King X Clunky. There's a lot of situations where you want a Murderous Cut. You go through a lot of your deck and you can find a lot of your deck because of the Wayfinders and the dig through times. And there's a lot of situations where like you'll need to like do something like Silengar's Command, bounce my pact, kill your guy, and then you'll also need to kill a guy with a flashback Murderous Cut from Jace. So the one mana opposed to the three mana over a long game is like really important.
Sure. Okay. I mean Silengar's Command. I saw you. This was awesome. Return target permanent to its owner's hand. If you're playing with Demonic Pact, this is an important card.
It's the most playable answer to your own Demonic Packs. The sweetest thing that happened with me with that card for me this weekend is I was playing against Makito Mihara, and he was playing the Rally deck. And he goes all in, pumping up the Nantuko Husk and plays a Rally to kill it, to make it lethal. So I counter the Rally and bounces Nantuko Husk.
Oh, wow.
It's bad Cryptic Command, it's still really good.
So, bad Cruel Ultimatum, still good.
Bad Cryptic Command, still good. We're just playing a bad Modern deck.
It was funny, I saw a thing where you had to actually kill your own untransformed Jace.
Yeah.
And to bounce your pact, you were like really up against it. Your pact was ticking down.
That was my own fault. I forgot that you had to have two targets for Silengar's Command, and I played a Jace the previous turn for no reason. So, that's my fault.
Okay. All right. Let's move on and look at some of the, you know, sort of just control elements, you know, that you're thought seizing.
You got to get rid of your opponent's counter spells, get rid of the key cards.
I was just
going to
say, what are the cards you really want to take out of their hand when you're playing the game early?
So because you have Languish and Demonic Pact, which kill everything with Toughness 4 really well, this card frequently gets like Siege Rhino out of Abzan, like Pelucrano sometimes, counter spells, other Thoughtseizes sometimes even. Just make sure that you don't die to the things that your pieces don't interact with favorably.
Okay. How about Sultai Charm?
Sultai Charm's awesome.
it's so funny. I'm like, you know, very specific. Sultai Charm has a very specific role here this weekend.
Yeah. The specific thing about it is that it kills Gaia's Revenge.
Yeah.
A lot of the Devotion decks are playing Gaia's Revenge, and this is the only card we have that actually kills him. We don't have Crux. We only have Languish and stuff. We need to be able to kill that. It also kills our Demonic Pact in a pinch. And it's Ultimate Price. And Ultimate Price is a good card, so no problems there.
So Hero's Downfall.
Yep.
You talked about this. You have the one Murderous Cut as your fourth, and then of course three Disperse.
It's the most effective way to deal with your own pact. Turn six, disperse my pact, replay it again. Let's play a second Cruel Ultimatum. It's just really good. It's the interesting thing is that we're playing it over Void Snare because Disperse actually has way more applications in long controller games. Let's say you have an Ugin that's ticking up. Your opponent goes down for your Ugin. You can respond by dispersing your Ugin. It's like Remand in Modern in that. We're just playing bad Modern cards. Save your own guys to disperse all the time.
I love how you're trying to find all these standard proxies for Modern cards.
I like Modern. What can I say?
Okay, let's take a look at some more of the cards. Did we miss an Ultimate Price, or is that on the...
Ultimate Price is only in the sideboard.
Oh, it's only in the sideboard. Okay, because I heard you talking about that.
These are lands.
Oh, Opulent Palace, Temple of Mystery, Temple of Malady, Temple of Deceit.
Let us cast our spells.
What's that?
These let us cast our spells.
Yeah.
Very important.
How hard is it to balance the three colors?
Mana's fine.
Yeah.
The blue's actually very light. It's basically for Jason and a couple other pieces.
Right.
Like, mana's fine.
Okay. Let's look at some more things that let you cast your spells. There we go.
We have to play two forests because of Nissa. Would not play it otherwise. But the Nissa's actually really good. And it's fine. So it doesn't matter.
So you just need to have a target that you can get.
You don't want to play one Nissa in forest because then it's just blank half the time. And two mixture, it's fine. Need green anyways. It's all good.
Okay. So let's take a look a little bit at the sideboard. There's the Ultimate Price you were mentioning. Ashiok, two Treasure Cruise, Disdainful Stroke. What's the most frequently sided in card here?
Out of these ones, it's been Disdainful Stroke because I played the most against like Devotion and Abzan decks where you need it. But the Treasure Cruise Ashiok thing is largely for matchups where we have to sometimes board out the Demonic Pact plan. If your opponent's playing like Dromoka's Commands, all that kind of stuff, if they're like really control deck, you can't rely on that as your engine, so you need other ways to do it. These cards slot in perfectly. Just do it.
Okay.
Sheila Buff, just do it.
Let's take a look at just the rest of the sideboard. A little nod to red.
Yeah.
Is that enough?
I'll be honest, I took a draw early in the tournament. I haven't played against red yet. in testing, I was winning against it about 50% of the time, so it was all right. But I'm hoping we don't need these Feed the Clans, but that's what they're there for.
Okay, negate, Sultai, Charm, Duress, Charm, Charm.
Kills guy's revenge.
let me ask you a question, though. How often are you just playing the Demonic Pact and then hoping? You're like, you're playing like, there's a little bit of tension where you're like, I need to find an answer.
Sometimes. I will play it on turn four if I don't have an answer. It's just, you're going to draw into it. You have like, what, six draws or something before you find it, and the deck's right. Pretty heavy on that. You'll find a Jace, you'll find something.
Have you lost to it at all? I mean, have you had it where you're like, oh, I needed to find something, and I didn't?
I lost to it when I was playing against Wafo Tapa.
Who I would have assumed you got your draw against, but no.
I did not, somehow. I forgot that he was Wafo Tapa for a minute and only played around two counterspells rather than the four that were obviously in his hand. So, yeah, that happened. Whatever.
Okay, so, I mean, we've seen other versions of this deck this weekend. How do you think the two versions compare? There's like the Woodland Bellower Invasive Species combo.
So that one's sweet. We actually didn't see that deck at all. We didn't know about it. We saw it on Twitter the other day. It was on the Moto results the other day, and it was like this is really sweet. We don't have time to test it. We're all in on this. We're doing it.
Okay. And then would you recommend this for people going to Friday Night Magic this weekend?
Absolutely. This deck is the perfect FNM deck.
You definitely want to be playing Demonic Pact.
So
this card seems fun. He is having more fun than anyone else on the floor. Certainly more
Guaranteed.
Fun than his opponents.
Guaranteed.
For Daniel Fournier, this is Brian David Marshall from the Tournament Center.
Thank you.